Hi there. Hope everyone is blessed this day. This is James Lawrence, and I'm going to present this teaching to you and read some scriptures. It is on the subject of satanically oppressed and possessed people in the world. Now, I know some people say, well, this man, he talks about these types of things fairly often, so therefore he must be into demonology. Okay, I believe that term is broadened a bit because when Christians do look into this type of thing, which is a realistic fact in the Holy Bible, it will tell them in much detail and in many passages the reason being that it is warning people to stay away from occult practices and vile sinfulness. In other words, very extreme sin stronghold in your life, which draws the satanic evil powers into people's lives. Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life, as it says in John 14:6, while Satan, it says, comes not but for, or only to, steal, kill, and to destroy. And that's talking about people's lives and every aspect of their lives. And that's in John 10:10, where it says that about him. Now, oppression against Christians, negative influence from the outside of them. Oppression means from the outside, pressed in. Is far more common than is a Christian turning against God with sinful defiance and then becoming open to possession by a host from Satan. Now, when I say a host from Satan, you know, you've heard of the heavenly host, the angels of God. Well, Satan has hosts that work under his authority, and they are sent out. They are like a grid that covers the world, and everyone is being influenced in one way or another, whether that oppression is being battled against through the armor of God that Christians have, which the Bible describes in Ephesians chapter 6, and I would recommend you read that, or oppression for other reasons, to get someone discouraged or to get them to break covenant with God, which that's rare. Listen, I'm not saying that salvation is a flimsy thing and that it's not a real, true rebirth of the human spirit, because it is by miraculous means through the Holy Spirit when we receive the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. In other words, we receive him as our Lord and our Savior. Okay, so sometimes Satan is trying to discourage that. He's trying to discourage people through oppression, which can sometimes come in the form of persecution, so that they will not witness for the gospel of Jesus Christ. Okay, so those who do not have relationship with Jesus Christ by first receiving salvation in him to begin with, already have evil influences, in other words, demons, who oppress their lives and oppress other people through their lives if they allow it to. Often pleasure of some type is given to people who are oppressed, even possessed, so that they don't know what they are experiencing and that it is something extremely negative to them spiritually. Okay, what I'm saying here is that their lives are being destroyed, and they don't even know it. You know, there's scriptures in the Bible, in fact, I just looked at some today, that talk about there being pleasure in sin. And I think it was in Hebrews that one of them said that people would not, you know, enjoy just the pleasures of sin for a season, but they would rather you know, experience the good things of God and go ahead and allow that oppression to attempt to battle against them. But they, now I'm improvising here. I'm stating this is all in the scriptures, trust me. But instead they allow whatever persecution or oppression may come, but they defeat it through the word of God. Remember Jesus said, "Ye shall have persecution in the world, but be of good cheer, for I have overcome the world." That means we enter into the power of Jesus through prayer, continual prayer, and watching over our lives. What do we take in through our eyes, ears, and so forth? What do we speak from our mouth? Is it good or is it negative? And I'm not talking about the Word of Faith movement, which takes it a little bit far, and we use formulas and that type of thing. Not we, I'm saying from their perspective, you know, we use these different formulas God has given us in order to receive things from Him. There are no formulas, and God is sovereign, and He grants you what He wants you to have. If you think that riches are going to be good for you, guess what? God knows really what's best for you. And you may think, yeah, but riches will make me happy. And talk about not having oppression. If I had riches, I would give and everything, and maybe that you would, and I would, you know, just be free, you know. Get me a motorcycle and ride the roads, you know. Freedom, baby, and stuff like that. And there's nothing wrong with that within itself. You get what I'm saying? What I'm saying is the attitude that someone has about it. And so they may go a wrong direction, because riches can corrupt some people. I don't care if they are strong Christians. When riches come, sometimes they begin to bow to it. And the Bible says you cannot serve God and mammon. Mammon meaning riches. Okay, so if you come across that, that's what it means. It means riches. So a person can begin to pursue more and more riches, or be afraid they'll lose the riches they have, so they must maintain and do it through different means that are very money hungry. It's called filthy lucre in the Bible. Now, all of this I'm talking about are temptations, persecutions, oppressions from the devil. Now, Christians are oppressed. You may have friends that leave their friendship with you because you became a Christian. You're not of any use to us anymore. You're like, oh, come on, guys, look, hey, I think you misunderstood me. I'm not going to be, you know, preaching to you and stuff all the time. I may not, you know, like if you drink some beer or something like that, I may not join in and so forth. You know, people are always thinking they can raise up other people that are not with God and cause them to become with God in their lives. Often it becomes the opposite scenario. They will bring you down, and you will eventually be tempted by things they are doing. So really, in the case of people who say, I don't want you to be my friend anymore, you became a Christian, you're one of those fanatics that believes in organized religion. Well, relationship with Jesus Christ is not religion. It is a fact, and it is relationship with God. Okay, so they can say that, and just because you go to a church building, they just, the imagery of that, because of the perversion of the world that has made that kind of a, hey, holy rollers, and people who are so heavenly minded, they're of no earthly good, you know, and things like that. And that's what the world has pushed at us, even through comical type of things on television and so forth. It's really too bad, because it gives a very wrong impression of people who are sincerely seeking strong relationship with God. First of all, by receiving Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, as I mentioned before. But it says that there is pleasure in sin for a season, but the way thereof is the way of death. Okay, now I mentioned the one in Hebrews that says that to that effect. There was another one, and I couldn't find it just right off the bat, but I've quoted it before. I know it's in there, that it's pleasure for just a season, but the end thereof is really negative things for a person's life. And it may not happen for a while. Satan lures them and gets them deeper into it through oppression, temptation, persecution from friends, peer pressure, you want to call it that? Okay, and things like that. Even grown-ups have that problem. But I'm going to read some scriptures to you that are quite fascinating, folks. They really, really are. And I want you to hear this carefully. First, I'm going to start off with Ephesians chapter 2, verses 1 through 3. 1 through 3. And you hath he quickened. Okay, let me insert here. He's talking to Christians. He's made them, God has made us alive in our spirits. Our spirits were dead in sin, but Jesus raised us up and made us alive in the Holy Spirit. Okay, now we may still have sin temptation. We may even sin on occasion. But we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous. And the Bible says if we confess our sins, He is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. So we do need to use that option for forgiveness if you're a Christian, because you're going to find yourself failing here and there. Okay, people who say they don't, it's just like John said, if you say that you have, present tense, no sin, talking to a church and including himself, he said, if we say that we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. He also said, if you say you have not sinned, like in the past before you were born again, that you lie, you know, that you make God a liar. So these types of things. So anyway, Christians will have sin, but they do not enter into a sin stronghold. This is where Satan really grips them with oppression, and he causes that sin to amplify in their life. It becomes so very powerful that they find themselves doing it, even though the day before they felt like they fully repented. But here comes Satan to put that back on them again. Now, there are Christians that have sin struggles, and people are saying, oh, no, they don't. No, you can't. The Bible says if you're in God, you cannot sin. Well, what that means is that you're not going to remain in sin, and you're not going to enter into it as a life practice. You're still going to worship God and ask his forgiveness when you slip and fail. Okay? And if you're playing games with God and you're testing him, tempting him, do not tempt the Lord thy God, is one of the Ten Commandments. But it's also all through the New Testament. We don't play games with God and say, well, Lord, I'm sorry. I did that, went to that beer bust and got really drunk and had a hangover this morning. But I know I did it last week too. But Lord, I'm repenting of that, okay? You will forgive me again, right? You know, now listen, if you don't think that people don't get that insincere about forgiveness, receiving forgiveness for God, think again. There are Christians who do exactly what I just described, maybe not exactly, very close to it. It's a dangerous position to be in because you can eventually slip away from relationship with God, or fellowship first, and then long enough with that until you finally say, God, I don't want you. I want this. I'm enjoying this. And, you know, I'm kind of having doubts and stuff about you. Why? Because they haven't stayed solid with the Lord through prayer and reading his word and hearing his word preached and taught. Therefore, doubts begin to enter their minds too, and they become very powerful. They kind of resist them for a while. Pretty soon, Satan wins in that stronghold, and he draws them away. Now, folks, I'm telling you the truth about this, about these powers of darkness that are described in Ephesians chapter 6, where it says that we don't wrestle against flesh and blood, even though it may seem like it, because that flesh and blood has something else working through it. They, him, her, whoever, is oppressing you, persecuting you, trying to draw you into sin and temptation. But that's not really them. It's the spiritual influence behind them. And even if you have a spiritual influence to sin and there's no one that's doing it to you, but you just begin to let your mind go toward these things, it's the same thing. It's still a stronghold, a foothold first, and then a stronghold. Satan actually sets up camp around you with his spirits. The Bible says that the angels of God that are holy encamp around those who are gods and delivereth them. You know, when we need deliverance, these angels of God help us with deliverance, and they will help us fight these evil influences. In fact, their power is far greater than what we have, but the greatest power is Jesus Christ and him present in our hearts through the power of the Holy Ghost. So really, there's no greater power than what's already in you. The Bible even says, greater is he who is in you than he who is in the world. And I already quoted the one where Jesus said, be of good cheer, I've overcome the world. And he did that through his death, burial, and resurrection. Okay. Let me read the rest of this scripture. I stopped right real early into it. And you hath he quickened, or made alive, who were dead in trespasses and sins, wherein in time past you walked according to the course of this world, according to the prince of the power of the air, the spirit that now worketh in the children of disobedience, among whom also we all had our conversation in times past, in the lusts of our flesh, fulfilling the desires of the flesh and of the mind, and were by nature the children of wrath, even as others. And he's talking about others who have not come to this saving knowledge, or Maybe they had, but they still wouldn't receive Jesus Christ. Listen, if you get a good witness and your heart is convicted, do not delay receiving salvation. It's very dangerous. You're not promised the rest of the day, let alone tomorrow, the next day, or next year. Something could happen. Very unexpected. God forbid that it should to you. But I'm just saying, you're not promised tomorrow. I'll just put it that way. And I've said it before in other videos. But here's another one. Ephesians chapter 6, verse 12. For we, Paul to a church, and including himself, he says, for we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. Okay, so this wrestling itself, to me, is showing this oppression that will be attempted upon you, persecution and sin, temptation, strongholds, as I said before, sins that you're lured into, and they will try to set up camp in your life, and that's a stronghold. That doesn't mean that you're not going to heaven, but over time, it could very definitely. It's not a good position to put yourself in at all if you're a Christian. Now, if you're not already a Christian, I'm going to say again, today's the acceptable day. Receive Jesus Christ, okay? Don't delay it. Now, Acts chapter 19, verse 13 through 20. Very interesting. This is in the book of Acts where the apostles are going to different places to preach the gospel. And different things would happen along the way. In this one, it talks about some men who thought that they were exorcists. Okay, it says that in the Bible. And they were going to try to cast out demons out of somebody, or a demon, whatever the case may be. Okay, let me read it. Acts 19, 13 through 20. Then certain of the vagabond Jews, exorcists, took upon them to call over them which had evil spirits the name of the Lord Jesus, saying, we adjure you by Jesus whom Paul preacheth. Not Jesus who's in us, by the power of him I speak his name. No, they said, we adjure you in the name of Jesus whom Paul preaches about. And there were seven sons of Sceva, a Jew and priest and chief of the priests, which did so. Okay? Seven sons of Sceva, they tried to exorcise the demon, cast him out. And the evil spirit answered and said, oh, this is amazing. Jesus I know, and Paul I know, but who are you? And the man in whom the evil spirit was in leaped upon them and overcame them and prevailed against them, so that they fled out of that house naked and wounded. And this was known to all the Jews and Greeks, also dwelling at Ephesus. This happened at Ephesus. And fear fell upon them all. And the name of the Lord Jesus was magnified. And many that believed came and confessed and showed their deeds, their evil deeds. Many of them also which used curious arts brought their books together and burned them before all men. And they counted the price of all these books and paraphernalia, I guess you could call it, of occultism, and found it to be worth 50,000 pieces of silver. So mighty grew the word of God and prevailed in Ephesus because of this. Okay, so these men were attacked by a demon, and it overcame them and even wounded them and ripped their clothes. Well, through the man. The man had superhuman strength. Okay, so the spirit decided, hey, you're trying to cast me out, and you're not even with the Lord Jesus Christ. You're not even filled with the Holy Spirit. Who are you to tell me this? Okay, so anyway, the people all came out and took their occultic books and burned them. And that's what was worth 50,000 pieces of silver. Have you ever heard of anybody that played with Ouija boards and tarot cards and things like that? And sometimes they will burn them because they realize it's bringing wickedness and evil influence into their home, or wherever they may use them. Ouija board is a toy for kids. How can that be? How should that be? So folks, if you have anything like that, get rid of it. Really, get rid of it. Destroy it totally. Burn it if you can, or some other way. You destroy it and come to the Lord Jesus Christ, and you will learn through his word and prayer, through prayer to him, how to overcome these satanic powers that may try to oppress or even possess you. Okay? Thank you for hearing. And I'm not trying to, listen, scare tactic? Sure, call it that. The Bible uses it all throughout the scriptures. It warns about Satan and his devices. Okay? It says that. And that he will persecute and tempt you, especially you're drawn away of your own lust. It says in James, let no man say that when I'm tempted of God. Who's left? Satan and his cohorts will tempt people on the earth every day of their lives. That means there's a massive number of them. But you know what? Two-thirds of the angels that did not fall when Satan rebelled as a holy angel in heaven and took them down with him, there were two-thirds left. One-third is all he brought down with him. They are outnumbered 2-1. And besides that, greater is he who is in us when we receive Jesus Christ than he who is in the world. Praise God. Thank you for hearing me. God bless you, and I'll talk to you again soon. This is James Lawrence saying goodbye for now.